Good afternoon, everybody. Well, good morning to some of you. Good evening to some of you, depending on where you are on the globe. Thank you very much for joining us for this special webinar. My name is Roshni Abraham, and I will be moderating today's webinar. I'm very delighted to announce this new partnership between CIS and ISAID, which is the International Society for Systemic Autoinflammatory Diseases. And it is our great pleasure to have the first CIS-ISAID joint webinar presented by a leading expert in the field of autoinflammatory diseases, Dr. Marco Gattone. Dr. Gattone is a pediatric rheumatologist who's at the Gaslini Institute in Genoa, Italy. He's the head of the unit of autoinflammatory diseases and immune deficiencies. And Professor Gattone has been very active in this field for many years and has significant expertise and interest in the clinical and pathogenic characterization of autoinflammatory diseases. He's a well-recognized expert who has published more than 200 papers in this area, and he's also the editor of the book, Familial Mediterranean Fever. He's also the current president of the ISAID, or the International Society for Systemic Autoinflammatory Diseases. And he has been very actively involved in a number of projects in Europe related to autoinflammatory diseases, including being the PI of the Eurofever project, the past chairman of the Working Party for Autoinflammatory Diseases of the Pediatric Rheumatology European Society. So without a doubt, I would like to welcome Dr. Gattone to speak to us today on the pathogenic mechanisms of monogenic autoinflammatory diseases. I would like to remind everybody on the webinar to please mute your phone so that there's no background interference. And if you have any questions for Dr. Gattone, please type it into the attendee chat button. You'll see that on the top left-hand corner of your screen. And once Professor Gattone finishes speaking, I will read out the questions to him for his response. So without any further ado, Professor Gattone, I turn it over to you.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Abraham, for this very nice invitation, kind invitation that is very, very welcome. I think that a close relationship between CIS and the Society for Autoinflammatory Disease is really, really relevant, and we hope to have more and more initiatives to cover the field of these diseases that, of course, are of great interest for many doctors involved in the study of clinical immunology. So thank you very much. Today I will talk to you about the pathogenesis, some points related to pathogenesis of the monogenic autoinflammatory diseases. You know very well that these diseases are monogenic disease caused by mutation of genes that are involved in the innate immune response, and that usually lead to a sterile inflammation that sometimes, of course, give some problem in differential diagnosis with many other conditions, including infection. Here you can see our father, great father that is Dan Kaster, that you know very well, that was the man that in 1999, let's say, think about this new name as autoinflammatory disease, just to distinguish, as you know, from the classical autoimmune disease, because as you know, these diseases do not have a clear association with class 2, HLA-A, or gender disproportion. They do not have pathogenic autoantibodies or antigen-specific T cells. We are brand new, much, much newer than the classical immunodeficiency because the first disease we have just 21 year old now, because the first gene was identified in 1997, was the gene of a familiar Mediterranean fever that we see. You know very well how innate immunity is important in the first steps of the response to infections, and how, of course, the cells of innate immunity are capable to recognize a number of pathogen-associated molecular patterns and damage-associated molecular patterns, thanks to the presence of receptors and sensors that can be in the membrane of cells, in the endosome, especially for viral infection, and also in some cytoplasmatic sensor that are able really to recognize pumps and dumps. This is, as you know, how the cells of innate immunity are activated. And after this activation, a number of intracellular pathways are activated, and usually going to the production to a number of very relevant cytokines, pro-inflammatory cytokines, that will be the focus, the main focus of our talk. How these mutation of protein and genes and protein that are related to this pathway lead to a sterile inflammation and a very severe inflammatory phenotype. You can see a limited list, because now there are many more autoinflammatory diseases, proper autoinflammatory disease, in which the clinical feature is mainly inflammatory, in which there are not, let's say, also sign of immunodeficiency, because you know that very well that there are a growing number of diseases in which autoinflammation and immunodeficiency are present. I'm talking today about the main disease in which the main and the prevalent mechanism is related to clinical manifestation is related to a huge inflammation and a, let's say, rheumatological presentation. As you can see here in the table, at the beginning of the story, almost all autoinflammatory disease were periodic fever. And at the beginning, as you know, there was indeed a synonym. Autoinflammatory disease were also known as periodic fevers. But you know that every year, and now every 2 or 3 months, a new disease has been discovered. And as you understand here from this table, is not just a matter of recurrent of periodic fever as clinical phenotype, but you can see here from this table that a wide variety of clinical presentation can be associated to genes that are linked to innate immunity and can be the presentation of autoinflammatory disease. This is very interesting because, as you understand, as for immunodeficiency, autoinflammatory disease can be a very interesting model in nature to understand some relevant, also multifactorial inflammatory diseases that are, and we will show you some example later on. I will start talking about this is my agenda, the inflammasome, NLRP3 inflammasome, that is a prototype of the autoinflammatory disease, then other inflammasome, the role of cytoskeleton, and then alternative pathways of autoinflammation. This is, in a way, the agenda of today's presentation. I think that you know very well the clinical spectrum of this very, very serious inflammatory disease. That is the disease linked to mutation of this gene, NLRP3, that code from this protein that is cryopyrin. You know, this is a wide range of clinical manifestation, from familiar cold autoinflammatory disease to macro wells and the very severe SINCA or NOMID, in which the patient since the very early day of life start to have urticaria rash, chronic meningitis, aseptic meningitis, hearing loss, and systemic inflammation. As you know very well, this disease is in a way the prototype of an autoinflammatory disease. We are really in depth with this man, that is Jürg Chop, that was a Swiss biochemistry that unfortunately passed away some year ago. And it was very important because he was able to understand indeed which is the crucial role and the intracellular mechanism that lead to the production of and secretion of IL-1. We also in depth with this guy that is an Italian guy, that is Charles Di Mavello, that was the man that many years ago, during the 70s, was able to clone for the first time and to identify one of the most potent cytokines, pro-inflammatory cytokine, that is IL-1 beta. What is really relevant that we know now that NLRP3 play a pivotal role, as you know, in the activation and secretion of IL-1. We know that for the cleavage of pro-IL-1 after the stimulation with of the toll like receptors through an alternative route of secretion, is important that pro-IL-1 is cleaved and caspase 1 is the enzyme that is able to cleave pro-IL-1. And thanks to your job, we understood that there is a system, a multi-protein system in the cells in which NLRP3, cryopyrin is very important because it's a sort of intracellular sensor for pumps and dumps. And this protein is able to, when it's activated, is able to link with other proteins and to activate caspase 1 for the cleavage of IL-1 beta. In this system, of course, there are different steps of regulation. ATP, for example, is very relevant because ATP that is produced during the inflammation is a relevant second signal. Usually the patient, the normal individual, needs both LPS, first signal, and ATP to produce huge amount of IL-1. This is a clear example. Many years ago, when we start to study patients with these diseases, we understood that was a completely different kind of secretion and pattern of secretion of this patient in comparison to healthy control. And you can see this in an experiment in which we use healthy donors and we stimulate the monocytes after isolation in culture with LPS. You can see after 3 hours of LPS, there is some secretion of active form of IL-1, but when you add the second signal, ATP, you have a robust secretion of IL-1. This is what happens in healthy donors. And you can see here what happened in CAPS and NLRP3 mutated patient. That is dramatic. You can see here that after just one single signal, LPS, the patient are able to secrete huge amount of IL-1. And the adding of ATP is not able to add something to this patient, maybe in this patient, but in the other patient was not able to add something. So this patient responds just upon the first stimulation LPS without the need of the second signal. So a complete a different pathway, and that is related to, it's clear that this disease is related to the gain of function of NLRP3. We will see other consequences of that. Of course, this was very relevant because we understood, thanks to the NLRP3 mediated diseases, that IL-1 was really crucial for these diseases. You know that we have in our body the possibility to dampen the overactivation of IL-1 through the production of a cytokine that is IL-1 receptor antagonist that is produced by the monocytes themselves, and to compete with IL-1 at the level of the receptors. And this is an important moment of homeostasis for IL-1 because this prevents an excessive activation of the IL-1 pathway. And that was very important because thanks to the knowledge of the pathogenesis, we were able to, we were lucky enough to have in the rheumatology field an inhibitor of IL-1 that was his recombinant IL-1 receptor antagonist that was used for the first time in UK, in London, in patients with Michael Wells. And you can see here the classical example of a fantastic response treatment, a patient that we treated many years ago. You can see here every day, this was a nomic patient with every day skin manifestation, fever, arthralgia, headache, and so on. The day after the first injection of anakinra, he was able to completely control the clinical manifestation with normalization acute phase reactants. As you know, there are other receptors, anti-IL-1 blockers that are now licensed for this indication and very effective as anakinra. This is very relevant because it leads to the fact that many of these conditions of inflammatory diseases respond very well to the blockade of IL-1. IL-1 was always thought about a relevant pro-inflammatory cytokine, but thanks to autoinflammatory disease, there was a great interest on the possible pathogenetic and also role of IL-1 as an important therapeutic strategy. Just to go on, to come back on this very old experiment that we have many years ago, I was a little bit nasty with you because I didn't show this patient. These three patients were SINCA patient, a NOMID patient, very severe. This patient was not, it was an intermediate phenotype, a Michael Wells. You can see here that this patient secrete have the same pattern, a lot of secretion of IL-1 after LPS, and very few after ATP. A completely different behavior in respect to healthy donors again, but not so huge amount of IL-1. This is important, very important, because this is also another aspect of the pathogenesis of the diseases. It's not important also only the production, the level of production of IL-1, but also the cinetic of production. You can see here, in fact, the normal individuals, if you stimulate the monocytes with LPS for 18 hours without ATP, you can see here that healthy individuals need 18 hours to have a good secretion of IL-1. You can see here how different is the behavior of the patient with a mutation of NLRP3. They have a very rapid and huge secretion after 3 hours and after a plateau. So not only a matter of level of secretion, but also a level of kinetic. This is very relevant and very important for our patient. And this is thanks to study that we have with Anna Rubartelli here in Genoa. We were able to understand that the real mechanism is related to an overactivation of the ROS of induction of reactive oxygen patients that are really activated in the monocytes of CAPS. And indeed, the patient have a huge ROS activation. That leads to the fact that this patient, the monocytes of this patient, are able to secrete huge amount of ATP after LPS. That means that this patient, due to the oxidative stress, are already prone to produce a huge amount of ATP, and as soon as they have the stimulation with LPS, they are able to secrete immediately a huge amount of IL-1 very, very rapidly. This is completely different from healthy individuals. And that also an important, relevant story, because you can see here how the patient with CAPS, monocytes of patient with CAPS, are able to produce our high amount, very high amount of IL-1, secrete high amount of IL-1, even at very, very low concentration of IL-1. So they are very sensitive for the production of IL-1. And this is related to the very huge and important oxidative stress of the cells and the production, the ability of the cells to produce high amount of ATP. This was very relevant in the last decade, because make the new field of autoinflammation, and we understood that the same system is related to different inflammatory condition, really, really frequent, much more frequent from the ultra-rare autoinflammatory diseases. For example, we understood that the gout, the crystal of gout, are able to induce the inflammatory part of the disease thanks to the NLRP3 inflammasome. That is the sensor of the crystal. And so IL-1 is very able also. And this was very interesting, because the rare autoinflammatory disease teach a lot about a different number of multifactorial autoinflammatory diseases, also because there are several different inducers of NLRP3 activation. You can see the crystal of arteriosclerosis, asbestosis, and the gout, and the beta amyloid for Alzheimer's disease, and so on. So it was a sort of revolution in the concept of many inflammatory diseases, thanks to these ultra-rare diseases. This here, another periodic fever, recurrent fever, that is TRAPS, that it was discovered by our colleague at NIH, the group of Dan Caster, by Michael McDermott and Yvonne Axantievich, that were able to identify the gene related to this disease, that is a prolonged fever episode with skin rash, skin rash, myalgia, and possible development of amyloidosis. This is very relevant, because the mutation of the disease is caused by mutation of the gene of TNF receptor 1. So mutation, one of the two receptors for another important pro-inflammatory cytokines. And this is very interesting, because at the beginning we thought that the main pathogenic mechanism of this disease was a defect of shedding of the receptors. You know that the shedding of TNF receptor is very relevant, because after the shedding, the receptor is able to block TNF in the circulation. And this is a relevant mechanism of homeostasis for TNF. So at the beginning, we thought that the main pathogenic mechanism was related to the defect of shedding. Then there was also the possibility that these patients have also a defect of apoptosis, because again, TNF receptor 1 is very important also for the induction of apoptosis. But the most relevant defect, and now that is very well known as the most relevant, was the fact that the disease is characterized, the severe mutation of the gene are associated to a defect of trafficking of the receptors. The receptors is not able to reach the membrane, the mutated receptors is not able to reach the membrane, is in a way entrapped in endoplasmatic reticulum, and this leads to a severe ER stress that is able to overactivate the cells in terms of oxidative stress, activation of different pro-inflammatory pathway. We also observe in our lab an impaired autophagy that is linked in a way to an activation of NLRP3. In fact, that is very, very strange part of the story. This patient produced high amount of IL-1, the monocyte of this patient produced IL-1 of IL-1, and These diseases do not respond very well to anti-TNF treatment. That was the first treatment that has been proposed with etanercept, the recombinant TNF receptors. But they respond very well to anti-IL-1 treatment. So even this disease, thanks to this mechanism of ER stress and activation of different pathways, in a way is linked to an overactivation of IL-1, and they respond very well to blockage of IL-1 anakinra or monoclonal antibodies for IL-1 beta. Other inflammasome, of course, not only the NAD3 inflammasome is important in our cells, we have a number of other structures that are very similar to NLRP3, and they are able to recognize different pumps and dams. Most of these inflammasomes are associated with different diseases, autoinflammatory disease. You can see here from this picture that another important pro-inflammatory cytokine is produced by the activation of the inflammasome, not only IL-1 beta, but also IL-18, that have the same alternative route of activation and secretion. This is very important because some years ago, two different groups described mutation of another protein of the inflammasome, of the family of the inflammasome, that is NLRC4, that is associated with a severe diseases characterized by an enterocolitis. And what is very striking in these diseases, and is not observed in NLRP3 mutated disease, NLRP3 mediated diseases, is the presence in this patient of a very severe flare of macrophage activation syndrome. You know that this is a very relevant complication that we have in pediatric rheumatology for systemic onset juvenile idiopathic arthritis. This patient can have a huge macrophage activation syndrome that can be very dangerous and very, very lethal, and sometimes lethal for this patient. And that was the case from some of the patients of these families that died for a severe macrophage activation syndrome. What was very striking in the paper that the monocyte patient with an NLRC3 produced as a NOMID patient a high amount of IL-1, but in comparison to a SINCA NOMID patient, what is striking this patient that they are really able to produce a very high amount of IL-18. This is rather typical of this disease. And this is also very, very relevant because you know how IL-18 is the role of IL-18 for the induction and production of interferon gamma, and how interferon gamma is important for activation of the macrophage, and how it's crucial for the macrophage activation syndrome. So again, a monogenic disease is very similar to a multisystemic inflammatory disease like systemic onset juvenile idiopathic arthritis, in which the mass is activated by IL-18. And this is very similar to what we observe in systemic onset juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Then we go to the familial Mediterranean fever. You know very well the clinical phenotype of familial Mediterranean fever, and you know that this is highly present in Jewish, Turkish, Armenians, and Arabs, with a very, very, very high prevalence of the carriers in this population. The gene was discovered again by the group of NIH and by a French consortium in 1997, and these MEF genes. I think this is the story of the comprehension of the pathogenesis of the disease is very, very, very interesting, because this should be theoretically an autosomal recessive disease, because the patient have usually a biallelic mutation of the gene. But so at the beginning, there was some study that they were looking for the possible loss of function of the disease. For many years, we didn't know, indeed, which was the physiological role of pyrin and why patients, of course, with pineal mutation display this very important inflammatory phenotype. At the beginning, we thought that pyrin could play a regulatory role on NALP3 inflammasome, but that was not the case. Just after some first observation, it was clear that the story is completely different. Now we know, thanks especially to this study, these two last study, we understand that first of all, pyrin is able to build its own inflammasome, the so-called pyrin inflammasome. And now we know also how this pyrin inflammasome is activated. this is a link to the role of these GTPases, rho GTPases, that are able to control these kinases that are in a way able to phosphorylate pyrin. When pyrin is phosphorylated, the inflammasome is blocked, is not activated. But when there is some homeostatic factor that make an alteration of GTPases, for example, some bacterial endotoxins, these lead to a deactivation of these kinases, dephosphorylation of pyrin. And so in this case, the pyrin can be activated. This is what another example how to show. This is the pyrin is in inactive forms, the pyrin in phosphorylated. So as soon as there is the inhibition of kinases, there is a dephosphorylation of this part, and of course, an activation of the pyrin. Here is interesting because all the part is related to the alteration of homeostasis of the cytoskeleton of the cells that is in a way linked to the presence of the endotoxin. So the alteration, the perturbation of the cytoskeleton lead to an activation of ROA. And this is rather relevant because and fascinating because some years ago, and there are a very recent paper again from this group that show that Yersinia pestis, Yersinia is one possible inducer of the activation of pyrin. And it's clear that patients with a mutation of MEF are more prone to be dephosphorylated. So they are more prone to activate the pyrin inflammasome. So you know very well how the Yersinia pestis was important in the Europe and not only Europe during the medieval time. And this is interesting. You can see the plague during the medieval time from China through the Silk Road. And you can see here that in the Mediterranean area, there was a huge amount of death for this plague. And was rather curious to see that indeed the development of the plague was rather similar to the distribution of the mutation of MEF through the Silk Road. So there is the possibility indeed that the high prevalence of MEF mutation in this population, Armenia and Middle East, could be related to this to a sort of positive selection of individuals that were carrier of MEF mutation that were more prone to activate the inflammasome and also more prone to defend themselves from the Yersinia. This is a rather interesting story that we will see in the future if confirmed. This is another interesting disease that is a very strange disease, a mevalonate kinase deficiency. Is a metabolic disease in which there is a defect of mevalonate kinases. It's very, very severe. Sometimes the complete enzymatic defect lead to this very severe disease that is mevalonic aciduria, in which the patient have a huge neurological manifestation, mental retardation, dysmorphine, and also inflammatory, persistent inflammation. But from the other side, you can have patients here like Giacomo, that is a normal patient, very intelligent, normal, very handsome, that have the classical mild mutation of the same gene, methylated kinases. These are mild because are associated with a residual enzymatic activity, more or less 30% of enzymatic activity. So the patient have a normal development, but they just have a periodic fever episode with very severe, with abdominal pain, vomiting, and so on. And of course, as usual, there is an also an intermediate phenotype, as like this patient coming from Tunisia. Again, now we know, thanks to the study of the JSA and other patient, another scientist, that indeed also for this metabolic disease, it showed that the effect of the metabolic pathway lead to an impaired protein prenylation that leads in a way to an overactivation of the pyrin inflammasome, and so overproduction of IL-1. That's why very recently there was an important paper showing that indeed the blockade of IL-1 with monoclonal antibodies is very effective and is now registered for the three diseases, FMF, TRAPS, IPRGD. I show you with three different mechanisms, but the final outcome, of course, is the overproduction of IL-1, and the very good response to IL-1 treatment is very relevant for the patient. Of course, some patients are very, very severe. For example, the patient from Tunisia that respond just partially to IL-1 blockade. And for this patient and for other patients with a very severe mutation of methylated kinase deficiency, stem cells transplantation indeed is a relevant possibility, as for this patient that have a fantastic response. Alternative pathway without inflammation, not only NLRP3 inflammasome, but other pathway. For example, you can see here, these are the not light receptor superfamily. There are all the NLRP3 and different inflammasome with different pumps and dams. But here you can see another sensor, intracellular sensor, that are the NOTs. NOTs are a different group of not like receptors that give rise to different pro-inflammatory activation, mainly linked to the overproduction of NF-kappa-B. An NF-kappa-B overactive action is another not NLRP3 mediated pathway for activation of many autoinflammatory diseases. This is the classical phenotype, the classical NF-kappa-B mediated diseases. That is the Blau syndrome, is a severe disease with polyarthritis, granulomatous polyarthritis, granulomatous rash, and uveitis, panuveitis, that is linked to mutation of CAT15, of NOT2, mutation of NACT domain, lead to an overactivation of NF-kappa-B. In this disease, the NLRP3 inflammasome and pyroinflammasome is not involved. There is a gain of function of this pathway, an overactivation of this pathway gain. In the keratinocyte, there is another protein that is called 14, not 15, 14, that have the same important role as a sensor for activation at the level of keratinocyte. There are some patients like these two twins in this family with this very severe erythrodermic psoriasis, pustular psoriasis, was very dramatic for them, in which the disease was related to gain of function mutation of CAR14 at the level of the skin, and again, overactivation of NF-kappa-B. I understood that in line there should be also Ivona Aksantievich, that is a great friend of mine, and also push a lot on this link initiative between CIS and ISAID. I'm very grateful to Ivona, not only for that, but also because she discovered a high number of the diseases that we are dealing with. This is an example These are diseases in which the patient have a phenotype that is very consistent with a Behçet-like disease with aphthosis, spatergy, intestinal involvement, and eye involvement also. It was very interesting because Ivona was able to show that the disease was related to the mutation of this gene that is coding for a protein called A20. Not only this disease, but another disease that again is associated with inflammation, gut involvement, panniculitis, and lipodystrophy. That is what is related to mutation of this protein that is called otolith. This is another disease that is linked to the overactivation of NF-kappa B, because both otolith and A20, the two genes that are associated to the these different diseases, are really relevant because they have a very important role in the ubiquitination. They are very important, the ubiquitinase enzyme. The ubiquitination is a process of a post-transcription process influencing protein activity. During the activation of the cells, there should be the ubiquitination of the cells, otolin of the pathway of for NF-kappa B production. Both otolin and A20 are able to reduce to act as a control the ubiquitination. So the lack of the function of these two proteins leads to an overproduction and over secretion of an over activation of NF-kappa B and overproduction of pro-inflammatory cytokines. This is another mechanism of inflammation, not only activation of the inflammasome or the overactivation of or poor control of NF-kappa B pathway, but there are other mechanisms, for example, impaired production of regulatory protein. This is the clear, let's say, example. This patient, again discovered by Ivona Xantievich, were not able to produce IL-1 receptor antagonists. So this patient have a lack of this very important homeostasis. They have this very severe and possibly lethal disease in which the patient have pustular psoriasis and osteomyelitis. This is linked to the completely absence of IL-1 receptor antagonist and over activation of the pathway of production and the pathway of IL-1. The same can be observed in a patient with this severe pustular psoriasis that can have a very, very dramatic flare. The same is related to the defect of IL-36 receptor antagonists. Patients that are not able to produce IL-36 receptor antagonists have the same huge pro-inflammatory pathway at the level of the skin. So there are two different examples of diseases that are linked to impaired production of regulatory protein. Recently, there are more and more and more different autoinflammatory diseases that are linked to different genes and also to completely different pathways. See, this is fascinating. Again, some years ago, as you know, again from NIH and in parallel from a group from Israel, there was the identification of a new disease, a disease in which the patient have a clear panarteritis with very early strokes, hemorrhagic and ischemic strokes. This disease is linked to mutation of adenosine deaminase 2. It's very dramatic, can lead to a severe alteration, neurological alteration, and is potentially lethal. ADA2 protein, as you know, has a homology with ADA1 that the people that are involved in the immune deficiency work know very well. Also, ADA2 has adenosine deaminase activity and that catalyzes the conversion of adenosine to deoxy adenosine. Is expressed on many cells, myeloid cells, monocytes, NK cells, T cells, and is a prototype of deaminase growth factors. It's very important for endothelial cells, lymphocytes, and macrophage. So we still don't know exactly how, which is the mechanism, but the patients that have a defect of either two are able to, are prone to activate the inflammation. There is a disbalance of the inflammation, more M1 pro-inflammatory and less M2 anti-inflammatory macrophage, and a huge, they are prone to activate the inflammation, and also at the level of endothelial cells. I finish my presentation with this last group of diseases. I usually start with this statement, a candle in the wind of autoinflammatory disease, because at the beginning of the story, we thought that this group of disease, new diseases, were not properly considered, could not properly consider it as a proper autoinflammatory disease. This is a group, there were a group of diseases, Nakayasu Nishimura, candle diseases, and also this condition that was observed in Maroc, in which there was panniculitis, lipodystrophy, arthritis, enthesitis, myositis, leukopenia, and some autoantibodies. These patients have mutation of this gene, PSMBA gene, and other gene associated to the proteasome. Proteasome, as you know, what was important in this disease is that for the first time, when we treat these diseases that were similar to autoinflammatory disease, we were not able to identify and to have a very good response that we observe usually in this condition with the classical anti-L1 and anti-TNF treatment. They do not respond at all. And these were called interferonopathies. Why interferonopathies? Because the proteasome, as you know, is a very important system to the degradation of non-lysosomal proteins in eukaryotic cells. These patients have a loss of function of these proteins that are able to build the proteasome. This leads to an overaccumulation of ubiquinated proteins that leads to a cellular stress that leads in these patients to an oversecretion of another cytokine that is not A1, TNF, IL-6. This is mainly interferon. Type 1 interferon. These patients have a huge type 1 interferon signature and over a STAT1 hyperphosphorylation that is able to respond to in vitro to JAK inhibitors. That was very interesting because, as you know, type 1 interferon is one of the cytokines that we use, our innate immunity use as an antiviral protein. They have the interferon have an important antiviral effect because as soon as it's produced after a viral infection, it gives signals to the cells to make a synthesis of antiviral proteins that are able to degrade the viruses and also to block the virus replication. So this is another set of cytokines that is very relevant for infection, viral infection. Of course, interferon alpha has and beta has a number of different, interaction with different cells types, B cells, T cells, and others. this leads to the identification of this disease that much more in advance in respect to the proteasome defect. Were identified as inflammatory disease linked to an overproduction of type 1 interferon. The Icardi Gutierrez syndrome is a neurological disease very similar to a torch infection in which the patient have a huge amount of intracranial production of type 1 interferon. They have this severe phenotype, neurological phenotype, but also some autoimmune manifestations, some thrombocytopenia, chilblains, and SLA-like manifestation. There are 7 genes that are linked to this disease, this condition, and all these genes are very important because all the genes are very relevant for, are involved in the clearing of the cellular nuclear acid debris. So a loss of function of these proteins lead to a defect of an overactivation of type 1 interferon, because this leads to an overactivation of type 1 interferon linked to the alteration of these enzymes that are very relevant for the degradation of viral RNA or DNA. And this leads to the relevance of mechanisms that are in the way linked to the control and activation of type 1 interferon. And this is the story of Marta that have this clinical phenotype with vesical papules and pustules and scars very early onset. You can see here with cheek lanes and angle dystrophy, this rash that is quite similar to dermatomyositis. She had some ANA positivity, and she had also a pulmonary involvement with a severe lung restriction. Marta was affected by this disease that is thing-associated vasculopathy with onset in infancy, SAVI, in which the genes is encoding for a protein sting that is stimulator of interferon genes. Again, this patient have a gain of function mutation in which there is an overactivation of the pathway of type 1 interferon genes, with a huge amount of type 1 interferons that go to the receptors and through JAK and STAT give rise to an overtranscription again to type 1 interferon. This is so a new class of disease, the interferonopathies, that are linked to different phenotypes, and they represent a very, very relevant and new entity. They respond quite well to JAK inhibitors. This is experience of NIH with the use of baricitinib. This is the study with Marta and other that we studied in Europe with ruxolitinib and other JAK inhibitors that indeed is able to ameliorate a lot the skin manifestation and the lung involvement. So I go to the end. Autoinflammatory disease, as you understood, is experimenting nature for the understanding of mechanisms regulating the inflammation. The study of CAPS and cryptic renal disease shed light on the function of an LRP3 inflammasome and is in a way the paradigm of the autoinflammatory disease. There are, of course, other new monogenic disease that more and more will identify novel pathway. We have seen the pyrene inflammasome, the other two, the difference of with DITRA and the production of other regulatory proteins. So it's very important that we will find in the next future other mechanisms that will help us in understanding the mechanism of many undefined autoinflammatory disease and maybe to find out a new target. I would like to thank all the people at the Gaslini Institute that work with me in the field of autoinflammatory disease, all the international collaborator, and of course I invite you. I know it's very close to the CIS meeting, but I really would like to invite you at the next meeting for autoinflammatory disease of International Society of Autoinflammatory Disease that will be held in Genoa next 31 of March and 3rd of April. I hope that some of you can come, because I think that this is a very nice meeting and we will discuss autoinflammatory disease and also bridging between autoinflammatory disease and immune dysregulation. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm very happy. I'm sorry, maybe we have a few minutes, but very happy to take some questions.
Thank you so much, Professor Gattorno, for your excellent overview on autoinflammatory diseases, the clinical phenotype, some treatment options, as well as pathogenic mechanisms. We do have time for a couple of questions for you, so I'm going to read them out to you, and if you could respond. So I think a number of our attendees would like to know what would be the best and easiest functional assay to evaluate disease causing mutations in these autoinflammatory disorders, you know, because not everybody has access to a sophisticated research lab. So what would you advise as the best and easiest functional assays to evaluate these patients?
Yes, it's a difficult question. It really depends about the facility that we have in our lab. I think many labs can have easily the production of IL-1 from circulating monocytes. It's not that difficult to study the kinetics of IL-1 after stimulation with LPS. That sometimes is something that can help to understand the kinetics of the cells of the IL-1 production. Is not useful, as you know, to measure IL-1 because IL-1 is not high in these diseases. It's different the measurement of ILT. Some groups and also we found that very high levels of ILT can be very, very relevant in some condition because especially inflammatory conditions, because can help us to understand the especially those that are more prone to macrophage activation syndrome. There are other screening tests that, however, are a little bit sophisticated. We use a lot of the interferon signature in our lab, and the other lab can do that. This is very useful to find out the production, the RNA expression of some, the gene expression of some, the expression of some genes that are downstreams interferon gamma. This is a very good screening test for interferonopathies, but I understand that is not very feasible in all the disease. From the clinical point of view, if I can say just a word, of course, the huge, very easy way to suspect an IL-1 mediated disease is to see the number of neutrophils. And if the neutrophils are very high in an inflammatory condition that mimic a systemic inflammation, that he has a systemic inflammation, I think that this is a prototype of IL-1 mediated response in which neutrophils are very, very high. So there are some few elementary data from the lab that we can use to orientate ourselves. I don't know.
Thank you very much. So if I were to summarize, you do not recommend measuring IL-1 beta in plasma or serum, as many clinical labs or clinicians tend to do. Rather, you would recommend an assessment of IL-1 beta production by monocytes after stimulation with LPS. Or if that is not available, then maybe look for neutrophilia as a clinical marker. Okay. One last and quick question. One of our attendees would like to know if there are any functional tests for A20 haploinsufficiency.
I don't know. Of course, you can. We don't know that. We do not perform that in our lab. Of course, you can measure the activation of NF-kappa B in the cells of the cells and to compare the activation of NF-kappa B that theoretically, and I'm sure that if Ivona can talk, can suggest some methods, I suppose that is not easy, is not that difficult in a normal lab to measure NF-kappa B activity upon stimulation of the cells in comparison to healthy control. You can measure easily with Western blot or other technique. And of course, that could be a good way to demonstrate an overactivation of NF-kappa B pathway.
Thank you. Yes, Ivona did respond, and she also mentioned measuring in vitro assessment of NF-kappa B activation Given that we are just over the hour, we'll have to stop our webinar right now. But Professor Gattone, on behalf of the CIS and all the attendees, and we've had an impressive list of attendees, close to 90 people, thank you so much for your presentation. And we look forward to future collaborations with ISAID.
Okay, thank you very much indeed to everybody. And thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. See you soon.
Bye. Bye-bye.